topics here. So I apologize because this is the name which was probably not announced officially of the course, but anyway, there is the name of Euler equation, I think, in my title, but I can change it because that was the original title I proposed. Anyway, so that's so maybe I start. So I will try to make a combination of whiteboard with slides. So basically, the lecture will be on the whiteboard, but I think sometimes it's better to have things written down clearly on the slides. There's a kind of lecture notes, which for the time being, they have like 27 pages, so it's not really a book, but that's something you can use. So I think they were sent to you or they are available. If not, you can visit. So I'm my home institution is Institute of Mathematics in Prague. So if you go to our website. You go to my personal webpage, then you can download all this material. For instance, the lecture notes. There is a part which is called lecture notes. There you can find the lecture notes, and I'm going to change them every day, basically according to how the course proceeds. So at the end of the course, we will have probably a new version. For the time being, there is 27 pages. Maybe at the end, we will have more. And I also welcome, you know, this is everything is like working version. So I also welcome any remarks. Like if you find there is a mistake in a formula, or you may think that something could be said differently, or please let me know and I will try to modify them. There are also slides for this course. They are not available on the web because I somehow can't put those. But of course, if you are interested, I can send them to you by email. You can contact me. Feel free to contact me by email and I will send you the slides. Okay, so this is basically for the first time when I was asked to do a mini course on some topic I didn't choose because convex integration is something where I am not really an expert. And, the title is completely different, but the course will be about the application of a universal method, which is sometimes called convex integration, which by itself the name is rather mysterious. I will speak about the application of this method to programs in fluid mechanics. And frankly, this is really a course for mathematicians because from the practical point of view or applications point of view, I mean, fluid mechanics is something with applications, right? I mean, you are not doing fluid mechanics because you like the equations, but you would like to obtain solutions of the problems. And at the end of the day, of course, you would like to have numerical schemes and you would like to compute solutions and you have really real-world problems you would like to attack. But I must say that convex integration of the method I speak about, which are basically related to the possibility of oscillations in solutions of certain problems, in particular of the Euler equations, they go in the opposite direction. Actually, they show you, as far as I know, there is not really any kind of numerical implementation of these methods because they just show you that one thing is equations in fluid mechanics and your physical intuition, and one thing is the exact mathematics. And actually, we will see that when we pass, for instance, to the concept of weak solutions in fluid mechanics, we may get something which is not really acceptable from the physical point of view. In particular, I will speak about the existence of infinitely many solutions for given initial data. So apparently these solutions, at least some of them, are not physical. So we go exactly in the opposite direction to what I would like to speak if I speak about fluid mechanics, meaning developing some methods and then finally solving problems by numerics. So here I think exactly the opposite. This is just mathematics and the talk is going to be about some dangerous thing that may happen. So roughly speaking, that's for the next slide. What is not allowed or what is not forbidden is allowed in convex integration. So there will be functions. I will speak about functions of fluid mechanics. Bigger font, yeah, okay. I will do my best. Then I don't have so much space, but So in fluid mechanics, usually you have systems of equations and you somehow expect that solutions. I mean, all problems in, I'm going to speak about continuum fluid mechanics, which means this is an idealization where you can imagine a fluid like a kind of continuum media and you try to describe it by means of systems of partial differential equations, typically nonlinear ones. So this is the idea behind this is that actually the flow, the motion of the fluid is described by means of something which is smooth. They are smooth quantities, they have derivatives, and they satisfy some system of differential equations. However, we will speak about functions which do not have derivatives. Actually, in the classical sense, they would have derivatives in the generalized mathematical sense. In particular, that could be continuous, but with no classical derivative. So these are objects which are very exotic, and that's something you would not really expect to see in fluid mechanics. And so I would somehow summarize this introduction. So in the past, we somehow saw that what is not allowed is forbidden. I mean, so it means that there was a certain set of problems in fluid mechanics, for instance, Euler equations. I mean, I will explain later what I mean if you are not really familiar with this. So there will be Euler equations, and there will be Navier-Stokes equations. And so for these problems, the idea was that, okay, so I hope it's now readable. The idea was that, well, maybe we do not have, so these are problems that are being used in engineering, right? And so people would say at the beginning, well, maybe we cannot solve them mathematically, but the model has been so efficient that actually it must be correct. And the engineers have used it many times, and it was used many times in numerical implementations. And, you know, planes are finally flying and cars are running. So these are good models. And the fact that mathematicians cannot solve them, by solving, I mean that, for instance, we cannot show for any initial data or any data in some sense the existence of solutions for these problems. It's only because mathematics is not so well developed. But finally, at the end of the day, these are good problems and they are well posed and we can solve them. And it's only mathematics, and sooner or later, we will get solutions. Well, today the situation is completely different, in particular in the context of Euler equations. I will try to convince you or to show you that actually Euler equations are desperately what is called in mathematics ill-posed. And this is an ill-posed problem in any sense. So you may, even if you start with some smooth initial data or you have a problem where you somehow believe that the problem should have a decent unique solution, then the theory actually tells you that it is not the case and there will be no way out. So there will be really, this is a kind of evolution in mathematical fluid mechanics. It was developed recently by certain people I will mention. And really, in particular in the context of Euler equations I will introduce later, we are really at the point where it's not clear what is a good solution of the problem. And even if the problem itself is like a well-posed problem, if it's a good one. Okay, so basically, all or many things I speak about, this is not my own work, so I'll be reproducing effort of some people, which was motivated, I think, at the beginning of everything, was the so-called Onsager's conjecture. Maybe I should say a few words about Onsager's conjecture. It's a kind of introduction. Later on, I will try to be more elementary. So there were many people who contributed, but my lecture is somehow based on the work of Camillo de Lellis and Laszlo Szekely. Well, strangely enough, these two guys were not finally the people who solved the Onsager's conjecture. The Onsager's conjecture was proved by Paul Hissel. I mean, the final result. However, there have been large amount of work and large amount, I would say, of ideas that were useful not only for solving this particular problem, but also for solving other problems, which I will speak about. And so there have been a lot of byproducts of the method they developed. So what is Onsager's conjecture is related to the Euler equations, to the equation. equations which are called incompressible equations. So, okay, so I'm using some fluid mechanics notation, or I would say engineering notation, but just let me know if you do not understand some symbols or something, because not everybody is working in this business. So, so the Euler equations, in the simplest form, they describe the motion of an incompressible fluid. And the fluid is inviscid, there is no viscosity. So that's not a very physical case, because in each real fluid there is a little bit of viscosity, right? But this is an idealization, so this is a model of inviscid. Later on I'll speak about compressible Euler equations in my talk, because I somehow like more compressible, and I would like also to contribute a little bit from my part. But the original motivation was incompressible. And so that's very a simple model where the only quantity to describe the motion of the fluid is the velocity. So you have u, which is the velocity of the fluid, so it's a vector function. Well, I will somehow omit this arrow there, but it's a vector function. So it's a vector field which ranges in the three-dimensional space, ideally, because the physical space is typically three-dimensional. And it's a function of time and the space variable x. So time belongs to some interval, say 0, 1, or 0, capital T, and x belongs to some domain, which is the domain occupied by the fluid. So I will speak about what is called sometimes Eulerian description, which is the description of the fluid where everything is related to fixed points of your physical space. So for instance, if I speak about velocity, I speak about velocity at this point. If I say point x, I'm here, and this is the velocity of the fluid, which is here. It's not like that I'm following the path. It would be the Lagrangian description. I do not want to mix up these two. Actually, the Lagrangian description was devised by Euler and vice versa. Anyway, so there is a system of equations that describe the time evolution of this velocity. And this is the following one. So we have time derivative of the velocity, plus a term, which is, so let me write it in this way later on. I mean, is it necessary that I explain the meaning of this notation? This is the scalar product of the gradient of u, which means that if the velocity has the component u1, u2, u3, this means that I take uj, I multiply it by the derivative dxj, and I take the component ui here, and I take the sum over j. J runs from 1 to 3. So this is the meaning of this term. And plus, there is some strange term, which is a gradient of some function, which is called pressure. So let me denote it by pi is equal to 0. And there is a second equation, which is the equation which somehow expresses the incompressibility of the fluid, which is the equation that the divergence of u is equal to 0. Again, I apologize if it's too boring for you, but what I mean by divergence of u has three components, u1, u2, u3, then divergence of u is a scalar vector field, which is dx1, u1 plus dx2, u2 plus dx3, u3. Sometimes you can also write it as a gradient scalar product. There are equations for each I. I have an equation like this. And I have dxi of pi here, right? That's the gradient. So this is for fixed I have the sum over j. So sometimes in the so-called Einstein notation, it goes along with this sum, and you just write it. And each time you see two indices that are the same, then this means that there is a sum over that. Okay, so that's the incompressible Euler. So these are two equations. So it's a very strange system in a way, because we have two equations, right? And for two unknowns, because there are two unknowns, there is a u, which is the velocity, but there is also the pressure pi. So this makes sense, because we are mathematicians, so if we have two equations, we want to have two unknowns. However, these are very strange equations, because this is just an evolutionary equation. this is a kind of stationary equation. There is no time derivative. And in particular, there is no time derivative of the pressure in the equations either, right? So it's itself, it's not really a standard equation. And so what would be a good problem to consider, for instance, I hope that this can be seen also on the camera, if I write here. So the good problem is the so-called initial value problem. So you take the velocity at the initial time, you can take zero, and you prescribe its value like to be u zero of x, right? And so that's the so-called Cauchy or initial value problem, and now you may ask, can I solve it or not? Well, so that's not the topic I would like to speak about. We know that this problem is basically well posed in the two dimensions. So I said I will speak about 3D case. So in the three-dimensional case, actually the existence of solutions for this problem of classical solutions is an open problem. We do not know whether or not, if I give you nice initial data, like smooth initial data, if the problem has a smooth solution. You can show that on a local time interval, zero, capital T, where capital T somehow depends on the initial norm. If you take smooth initial data, the problem will have smooth solution. However, we do not know if they are global or not. So for people who are familiar with the famous Millennium problem, which is Navier-Stokes, which is basically the same system, but you make a little change here, a graphical change, which makes a world of difference. You put Laplace here. That's Navier-Stokes, and the Millennium problem is exactly the same problem, meaning if I give you the initial data, can I show that there's a smooth solution if the initial data are nice? And this is an open problem for Navier-Stokes too. And for Euler, it looks like there is a less chance because, as you might know, this term will regularize considerably the equations. But if I forget it, it looks like there is a less chance to get smooth solutions because there is no Laplace here. However, the problem is still open. Despite of all these negative results I speak about, the basic problem for the incompressible Euler is still open in the sense that it still might be that for nice initial data, the problem would have nice solutions, and in that case, we can forget all this horror. However, it is not the case for compressible Euler. This is what I like also to speak about compressible Euler problem, which I will show you in one of the following lectures, where there is no chance. There, we know that even if we have nice initial data, we would have bad solutions after finite time, and there will be many. For the incompressible, that there is still a chance. However, I should finish this introduction. So what's the Onsager's conjecture for this problem? Okay, so given this, you write down something. What is the energy balance? What it means, the energy balance? Okay, so you take the equations, you multiply, you take, so these are vectors, so maybe I just write them in this vector notation, sorry, component-wise notation, so I have dt of ui, now I have ui dxj, uj dxj ui, the sum over js, plus, so now there is dxi of the pressure, and this is equal to zero, and I multiply them by ui, so I multiply the, so this is I runs from 1 to 3, I multiply by ui, and I take the sum over I, right? And so here, what you see, so I'm sorry if there are experts and I'm too slow, but I was told that I should start from really very beginning. So if I multiply by ui, I get d by dt ui multiplied by ui. But this happens to be nothing else than one half of the derivative of u squared, right? And if I take the sum over I, this is the derivative of the absolute value of u, of the norm of u. So the first term gives me one half of d by dt of u squared. And now I integrate over omega, over my domain. So, okay, so I should say there are some boundary conditions also. So let's assume, for instance, that the u vanishes at infinity and we are on the whole space. So I integrate over my domain omega. And so the first term gives me something like time derivative of the integral of one half of u squared. This quantity which is here is called the total energy of the fluid. This is the kinetic energy u squared, and you integrate over the whole physical space. So this is called kinetic energy. Now I continue by multiplying. So now at the second end, there is integral over omega. I have this sum over j's, ui, uj, dxj, ui, and it's multiplied by ui. But now you see dxj, ui, ui, this is 1/2 of dxj u square, ui square. But since there is a sum over j, this is just dxj of u square, of ui square, and then I put the derivative here, and I get, so this will cancel out, and I will get divergence of u here. So I will get u square, divergence of u. A divergence of u is zero if I integrate by parts. After integration by parts, this term will disappear. So there will be, so this term is not going to be there. And the same thing with the Rust term. So I have dxi pi ui. So again, I assume that I have a domain where everything vanishes at infinity, for instance, if omega is I. And so I can integrate by parts. I put dxi or ui. If I use Gauss Green theorem, so I will get minus pi divergence of u. I will get dxi, ui, the sum over i's, and this is divergence of u, but divergence of u is zero. So this term is not there, and so both terms will cancel out, and finally I get this expression, which means that the time derivative of this quantity is equal to zero, which means this is something quite natural, that the total energy of the fluid, if the boundary is, if the fluid occupies the whole space and the velocity vanishes at infinity, or I can take some reasonable boundary conditions, for instance, in this case, I can take something what is called impermeability boundary conditions. Which means that I want my boundary to be impermeable, which means the velocity itself should be always tangential to the boundary. There is no fluid that escapes, which can be mathematically written in the form that u is a vector scalar product. This is the normal vector on the boundary. This is the normal vector on the boundary, always vanishes. If I prescribe that, then I don't see all these terms, and the statement here tells me that the energy of the fluid is conserved. The time derivative of the energy is zero, so this is a constant of motion. Which makes sense because the fluid should not be losing energy. I mean, since the boundary is impermeable, so there is no motion through the boundary, and there is no viscosity, so there is no dissipation of the energy to the heat or something, of the mechanical energy to the heat, the mechanical or kinetic energy of the fluid should be conserved. Right? Well, this is of course true provided all these derivatives exist. Provided I have an object for which I can say, well, the gradient exists, time derivative exists, but we are mathematicians, we know that that's not always obvious, that there are functions which do not have derivatives. Still, you can solve the equations in what is called weak sense. I am not going to write down what is the weak solution right now, because later on we will see more exact definitions. But you can imagine that there is something what's called weak solution of this problem. Solution satisfies this equation in the sense of distributions, which means, roughly speaking, that all derivatives are understood in the generalized sense. Again, I really do not want to spend all my time on discussing incompressible Euler, so I hope that you can imagine what is a weak derivative in this sense. This means that I take equations as they are, I multiply them by some smooth function phi, which is sometimes denoted by this function, then I integrate over the domain and over time space, so I integrate from zero to time and integrate over omega. I assume that this is a function which has compact support. And I perform the integration by parts formally. So for instance, in this case, I put the time derivative on the test function, so I will get minus dt phi, and I don't see this dt here. And then I do the same thing with other terms, and I get something what is called weak formulation of the problem. And now I get weak solutions, and they are defined by means of these integral identities. So in particular, they do not have to have any derivatives. Right? They are defined even if these functions are only continuous, for instance, but even if these functions are only integrable. I mean, I even don't need continuity because we have Lebesgue integral, it doesn't need continuity. And so so I can have generalized solutions, and now the question is, do these generalized solutions have the same property? Because this, I mean, this identity makes sense also for generalized solutions. It tells you that this actually is a quantity which is independent of time. And in order to speak about this quantity, I only need the velocity to be square integrable over my physical space. Right, so the question is, can I have this for weak solutions? Because for weak solutions, I cannot perform these operations. I cannot multiply the equations by UI because these derivatives do not exist. And so the question is, can we have this or can it be violated? And there was a... And this is something which is connected to the theory of turbulence. So even a long time ago, Onsager's conjecture, I hope I get the exponent right, was the following. Onsager, and that was amazing because he even at that time, you know, the theory of weak solutions was not even like well developed. So he was talking about weak solutions, but sort of implicitly. Right? He had some concept of somewhat what we would call now. We would call now weak solution. And the conjecture was, yes, this is true, provided this function is Helder continuous. So U should belong, so these are these functions, it's continuous but no derivative, so the function should belong to Helder space. But now there is the question is, what is this alpha? And so there's a magic critical value in three dimensions, this is 1/3. And so the conjecture of Onsager was, so this is the space of Helder continuous functions. I have to explain what is Helder continuous function. Okay, so the conjecture was that if alpha is less than this, then even if I have weak solution, if I know that my weak solution belongs to this class, the function need not have any derivative, right? So this is how you can speak about weak solutions. So you don't have derivatives, but still it's quite a regular weak solution, I would say, because it's Helder continuous. So the conjecture was, yes, you have this, provided alpha is smaller, provided alpha is larger than this. If it's good, I mean, the larger exponent, the better the solution is. So the conjecture was, yes, if alpha is greater than 1/3. But the conjecture was that also no, if alpha is less than 1/3. So there is no, so the energy inequality, the energy balance can be violated. So the statement is that there could be weak solutions to the incompressible Euler, which are Helder continuous, but with a very small exponent, not very small, but small exponent, smaller than certain critical value, such that this is not true. In other words, this information is not contained in the equation, in the weak formulation of the problem. And so this is a famous conjecture, and finally it was solved. So Delevis and Segrini started to attack this problem and actually developed a beautiful theory, which is a kind of application of this abstract method, which is sometimes called convex integration, to the Euler system, in particular to this incompressible Euler system. However, there is a lot of interesting ideas that can be used also in the context of compressible Euler and other problems in fluid mechanics. And finally, the conjecture was solved quite recently by Poulisset, who was a student of Kleinerman. So he was not a student, neither Delevis nor Segrini. So Poulisset finally proved that indeed. So what is difficult on this conjecture, right? I should comment on it. So actually, there is a relatively easy part, which is this one, which means if you know that your solution is sufficiently regular, I mean, if the other exponent is sufficiently big, that you get energy equality, and that was shown by Konstantin E and TT some time ago in a paper which is pretty short. And the idea is, okay, it's a nice paper, but the idea is quite natural. I mean, you take something what you may call a regularization of this function U. So the idea is to multiply the equation by the velocity and perform the operations I need.
But since you cannot do that, you have to regularize the equation, and you have to regularize your test function, which is the velocity itself. So you take regularization by means of some convolution with some unsmooth schedule of the problem. You perform these operations. You get basically what you want, plus some remainder terms, which you put on the right-hand side of the equations. And it turns out that actually these remainder terms, now you send the regularization to zero, the parameter of the regularization to zero, and it turns out that if this is large enough, then this extra term will disappear in the limit, and you get this. And the method doesn't work when alpha is less than 1/3. No, I think this is still open. This is still open. What happens when alpha is 1/3? Yeah. As far as I know, there is no. This is like space-time, right? I mean, there have been several approximations. First, they prove it for Helder in space, but not necessarily in time. The conjecture is that you have solutions which are both Helder, which are Helder both in time and space, on the closed, right? And so, this part is relatively straightforward, but the other part is difficult. Which means you should find out solutions of Euler, which are weak solutions of this problem, that are quite nice. They are Helder continuous, but with an exponent which is small enough, and that do violate the energy balance. You may ask in which sense, and the final answer is that they can violate the energy balance in any sense you like. In particular, the final result here is that when you give me any function here, and I can say continuous function, and I can find the I can find the solution which has the energy whose energy has this profile, which means that the energy is not at all encoded in the equations. I mean, you can do whatever, and this is actually the final point, which was again finally proved by the Delevingne equal and other people. Okay, and so this is difficult because you have to find a relatively smooth function which, however, violates the energy inequality. And there were examples of this phenomena, but not in this class. So what was known, say, from 60s, the results of Schnirelmann and Schaeffer. So Schnirelmann and Schaeffer, they somehow were able to show for this problem, for this system, solutions that sometimes called the existence of solutions that are sometimes called nightmare solutions. I will explain why. These are solutions of the Euler system where you take the initial data u0 if x to be 0. There is nothing is going on. You take a glass of water, fluid, right? And then this cup, you fill it with water, you put it here, and the velocity is zero, so which means nothing is going on. And you leave it on your desk. And so what you expect, of course, is that, well, this problem, there is an obvious solution of the Euler system in this case, which is just u is equal to zero, right? I mean, this is, you can check easily that it's a solution of the problem. And that's something what you expect. I mean, if you do nothing with the water here, of course you do not expect the water to do something. I mean, the energy cannot come out of nothing, right? Well, however, Schnirelmann and Schaeffer, they were showing the existence mathematically, right? So it turns out that this problem has also solutions that are not trivial. These are solutions that have compact support both in time and space. So in particular in time, so what's going on? So this is time, right? So you start with zero solution. So this is, say, this is the absolute value of the velocity. So you start with the velocity which is zero, then the solution starts to do something. And then after a while, you go back, right? So this is to zero. And why this is called nightmare solution? This means like you go to sleep, you put a T on the desk here, right? Then you go to sleep, and you do not, and then the fluid is doing something, right? Which is something which you don't expect, but then you wake up here, and nothing is, you don't see anything because the fluid is again at rest. So apparently that's not a physical solution. Everybody knows that. But it's a solution which violates the energy inequality, apparently, because the energy here is zero, the energy here is zero, but in between it is not zero. Right? So, and these were solutions which were constructed by Schmirelmann and Schaeffer. But the construction was so difficult that it was not really. And the point is that these are really weak solutions. And the only information we have about these solutions are that they are square integrable. So these were solutions for which the energy U square was finite, say, at any time. So these are solutions which, mathematically speaking, belong to the space L2, right? You are, at any time, you are in the space of square integrable functions on your physical domain omega. Nothing more. I mean, that's the only information that you can get out of the method. So these are solutions which are not very regular, right? I mean, solutions in L2, they can have both kind of singularities. They can be sort of very oscillatory. It's only measurable function which is bounded, for instance, and they can be also singular to some that they could. So these solutions are really like bad solutions. And in particular, they violate the energy inequality in the bad sense, meaning they are producing energy. One would be able to accept somehow, I will also explain why, this kind of inequality, right? Which means that the energy is a non-increasing function of time, which means that the Euler system, solutions of the Euler system, are losing energy in some way, but they are not producing energy. So these are really bad solutions. Why solutions of this problem should lose energy? There is a reason, there is a physical reason why solutions should lose energy, and this is exactly the approximation by Navier-Stokes. So you do this little trick, you get Laplacian of U, which is now what we have is a Navier-Stokes system, right? And now you take epsilon as a parameter, so this is called viscosity. This adds, this represents a viscous fluid. There is certain internal friction in the fluid, which is always there. And actually, the Euler system is considered to be the limit case of this problem. This is Navier-Stokes. This should be the real physics. And now, if you send epsilon going to go to zero, solutions of this problem are somehow expected. This is still an open problem in many cases. Somehow expected to converge to the solution of our problem. And solutions of this problem, they do dissipate energy. They satisfy the energy inequality. And so why it could happen that for some reason this is somehow inherited by solutions of the limit system. So it's not so bad to assume the inequality here. However, these solutions, they do very bad things, right? And so you would say, okay, so on one hand, it's a mathematical curiosity that we have this kind of solutions. On the other hand, we don't have to care because we just discard it. We just say that all good solutions should do this, right? They should, and maybe there is only one good solution in this problem, which is zero, and it's true. If you start with zero initial data, of course, if you prescribe that, you cannot get out of zero, right? If the energy, if you have the solution which is zero initially and the energy is not increasing, then the solution must be zero. So it looks like everything is solved, but it's not. The situation is more subtle because, of course, there are also non-zero initial data. And so how this is related to Onsager's conjecture, well, this tells you that really there is a possibility of becoming warm. There is a possibility of having solutions which really violate the energy inequality, weak solutions. There are weak solutions, apparently, that violate the energy inequality, but they are not very regular, right? So the Onsager's conjecture is more challenging. It requires you to construct these solutions of this type, and actually the first example was of this type, but you want the solution to be Helder continuous everywhere. And that's not clear. I mean, we have L2 solution. And so that's the difficult part, and that was somehow attacked by the series of papers that finally culminated by the work by Isset. In the work of Isset, he really constructs solutions of this type, which starts from zero, it finishes in zero, but it Helder continues in between. But there is a nice byproduct of the whole theory is that actually this phenomena, which was somehow discovered by Schneerman and Schaeffer, is not restricted to zero solutions or solutions are starting from zero, that you may have solutions which do this, that's, which start from non-zero data, right? So you can have initial data which are non-zero. And so that's the energy, so this is the initial time. Now this is the energy, which is the integral 1/2 of u square. And now this the methods that have been developed by these two guys and others, other people, of course, I'm not mentioning all names, they finally show you that this is a byproduct of this study of Onsager's conjecture. It's not only that you have solutions. Okay, from this trivial example of Schneerman and Schaeffer, you can see that if you have such a solution, you can automatically say that for given initial data, in this case zero, there is infinitely many solutions. Why? Because you can continue like that, right? You can put, you have one solution which looks like one arm, and you have another solution which has two arms, another solution which has three, and so on. So for given initial data, you have infinitely many solutions, which is already some kind of disturbing, it's kind of disturbing, because you would like to have, in fluid mechanics, you would like to have problems which are deterministic, unless there is really some stochastic phenomena, we would like to have solutions that are determined by the initial data. Well, here we see it's not the case, but what is worse is that, well, by this convex integration method, finally, it turns out that there are initial data, not only that they produce Helder continuous solutions, which violate the energy inequality, but it can violate it in the physical way, which means that they really satisfy this inequality, and they start from, well, of course, then they must start from the initial data, which has positive energy. But they do something like that. Basically, you can choose any energy profile here, and you can construct solutions. And it's even more, as we will see in the course, we will show that you can not even that you choose the integral, you can choose the energy itself as a function of Tnx. And so, and that's very bad, because this means that there are bad solutions, and they are physical in the sense that they do not produce energy. In particular, they might be limits of Navier-Stokes, which is still, I think, an open problem. Maybe there is some recent development. Right? But this is everything. This is related to the incompressible case. So at the end of the day, even if we have a bad solution that violate the energy conservation, they can violate it in the physical sense, but still they are only, so to speak, Helder continuous, which means it does not exclude the possibility. This fact, all these disturbing facts, still do not exclude the possibility that if you give me initial data which are smooth, the solution of this problem will be smooth forever, and I will never see that. And this is, for me at least, like working in mathematics, it is still acceptable solution. Which means, after all, Helder, you know, problems in fluid mechanics were derived under the classical principles. So it was assumed that everything is smooth, right? Everything is continuous. Well, Helder functions are not smooth, so why should they satisfy some physical principles? I mean, the point is that if I start with nice initial data, I should get nice solutions, and this is still not excluded. However, there is a byproduct of this theory which applies to what is called compressible weather, and in that case, it's hopeless in the sense that, well, I will show you again. In that case, we have smooth data. They will give rise to infinitely many solutions, and they will satisfy the energy inequality in this sense. And so that's really a problem, because then this means that the Euler is not really well posed. Here, for the incompressible Euler, there is still a little chance. Huh? You may say, how about Navier-Stokes if you had epsilon? Well, so these results are not available, but they are available in a certain sense, which I am not able really to, I mean, I can explain what kind of results we have, but I'm not able to lecture about it, is that also for Navier-Stokes, recently it was proved the existence of these. Sometimes these solutions are called wild solutions. You may ask, what is the definition of wild solution? For me, wild solution is a solution which gives rise to, well, I would speak rather about wild initial data. So wild initial data are initial data that give rise to infinitely many solutions on my time interval. it was recently proved by Buckminster and proved recently that even for Navier strokes you can have wide solutions. However, these are not still the solutions one would like or one would not like to have, which are the so-called Lehre solutions. So I really do not want to make any big detour in the theory of Navier strokes. These are not really, still not really the physical solution. In particular, they do satisfy this inequality, but the energy inequality for Navier strokes is different. There is a term which depends on viscosity. Actually, the right energy inequality for Navier strokes is this thing. Okay, so there is 1/2 of U square plus, and now there is epsilon, gradient of U square, and this is the ring. This is a term which comes into play because of this. And solutions are that were constructed by Buckminster, or we call, I should not say constructed, I mean, they prove the existence of it. This is the problem that nothing is so-called constructed here. I mean, all these proofs are non-constructive. I mean, the proofs, the results I speak about are non-constructive in the sense that they tell you there exists solution like that, but they don't tell you how to get it, for instance, numerically. So this is still not available. I mean, this term, this means that you should have solutions with certain regularity, which means that the gradient should be a square integrable function. And it's not clear how to make convex integration work in this context. So we still, there is still some chance that for Navier strokes, we can have even decent, like weak solutions. Not only strong solutions are always good, but the problem is that we do not know if they exist in both, for both Euler and Navier strokes. Okay, so that was a very, very long introduction, but don't be, I mean, so I'm not going to continue in this way, right? I'm trying to do something more serious. This was like motivation. So actually, there was a baby, I would say, stage of these proofs, where finally everything culminated by constructing functions which are Hilbert continuous. However, the first step, this effort was actually construct solutions that do violate the energy inequality, but for general initial data, not like in the case of Schnellermann. And these solutions were L-infinity solutions. And so these are solutions that are bounded measurable functions. So U is not Hilbert. I mean, we do not know if U is Hilbert continuous or not. So U is the velocity U. Only bounded measurable function. And even so, in my talk, don't feel disappointed. I speak only about this. And basically, all these tools I will be using and I will be trying to explain are borrowed from the work by Deleuze and Zeghiridis. So I do not claim that there is some. My individual contribution in this case was not really, I mean, what we did was some results for the compressive Euler, which are, but everything you will see is basically done by means of these methods, right? So, and I will stay at this stage of L-infinity solutions, which sometimes people call baby convex integration, because the existence of Hilbert solutions is much more involved. And I would say the technique is very, very different. I mean, there is some. There are some principles that are the same behind it, but the technique is very, very different. Here, actually, the construction, at least the way I understand it, is based on the fact that Euler system, and this is actually the first part of my lecture, admits oscillations. Which means that there could be solutions of the Euler system. Again, I will go really into precise definitions in 1 or 2 minutes. Just to explain what I'm after, there can be solutions of the Euler system which behave, roughly speaking, as functions which can be described like sinus and x when n goes to infinity. So these are functions that oscillate very fast. And So the point of this L-infinity theory was to show that actually you may have solutions of the Euler system that are allowed to do to perform such kind of oscillation. And this is the key ingredient. So everything I mean, what I will speak about will finally boil down to what is called oscillatory lemma, or at least I call it oscillatory lemma. And I will try to reproduce the proof of it, where we will show that actually Euler system admits solutions which develop oscillations like that. And this is bad because we will see that this violates compactness and this violates stability of solutions. Right? And so I will say at this L infinity level. And so my really highlight was what is called oscillatory, or maybe one should call it oscillation. Well, if you do this Helder solution, then you must somehow change the strategy. You have to include some forcing terms in the equations, which will be also of oscillatory type, but they will vanish in the final limit. But it's something different. So I will really speak about this infinity version of the Galois integration in the context of Euler. And I will also show you how this can be applied to compressible Euler. And in contrast with the incompressible Euler, there is no analogy of the theory like Helder continuous solutions for the compressible Euler. So this is the only method that works in the case of compressible fluid. And as you will see at the end of the day, the results are very pessimistic, I would say, because it really shows that even for nice initial data, we can have bad solutions. Okay, so that was really very, very long introduction. But I somehow wanted to show what's behind all this. And now let's start with some more specific mathematics. So I start really very, very, from a very, very basic level, trying to explain what I mean by oscillations and concentrations. So because I have been repeating saying like oscillatory solutions, oscillations. So this is really the starting point of the course. So let me show you two elementary examples of very unpleasant phenomena. One is called oscillations and one is called concentration. So suppose that you want to solve a problem like a system of differential equations. So what you have to do, you have to show that the solutions of this problem admit something what is called a priori path, which means that you take your problem, you perform some operations, and so it will show you, these a priori bounds will show you that actually solutions of this problem are functions that must belong to some class. Because the fact that they have to solve this differential equation, even in a weak sense, would impose some restrictions on the solution. And somehow your hope is that this restriction will be so strong that if you take some approximation of your problem, about which you know that it has a solution, for instance, a numerical approximation, then if you let the approximation parameter to go to zero, you would recover your original solution. But for that, you need something what is in mathematics called compactness, right? Because now we are handling sequences of functions. These are infinite dimensional objects. We are not having like vectors. I mean, the finite dimensional space, like Rn, has the nice property that it's locally compact. So if you know that you have a set which is bounded in this space, then you can always pass to a subsequence which is compact, which is converging to something. Well, if I have a function, which means, roughly speaking, that instead of having finite number of points, I have infinite number of points, the issue becomes more delicate. And there are two basic obstacles that can prevent compactness, and these are oscillations and concentration. And oscillations typically occur, so iconic example of oscillations is function sinus and x, but let's do something more general. So let me take a function g. So the function g is periodic with period a. Right? So this is very elementary. So I take something like my sinus, and I assume that the average over the period is equal to zero. So it's like sinus and x over the period zero, right? Right, and now I construct a sequence which is Gn, which is G of nx, right? So it's so this is my G, right? So it's a periodic function. This is 0, this is a, it's a periodic function with zero mean, and I take g of n of x as g and x. So I'm rescaling this. Instead of having this, I take g2 is this, I g3, and so on. So I take something which oscillates faster and faster. Now I would like to say what is, this may happen. So imagine, for instance, then that I have Euler, and these are solutions of the Euler system. A priori, we cannot exclude that we have solutions that may do that. I mean, you may say, maybe you have some estimates, maybe this is impossible. Actually, I will try to convince you it is possible for Euler. So you can have functions like that. Now, what would you say is the limit of this, right? I mean, you would like to say, for instance, if this is a kind of, suppose that you have a numerical scheme and you have a sequence of functions like that, what is the limit? Because you would like to say, well, my numerical scheme converges to something. In which sense does this converge? So you may naively think, okay, it's a bounded sequence. Well, you can assume that this is a bounded function, right? I mean, I didn't say anything about regularity of G, but you can assume that it's a C-infinite function. So you have a bounded function. So you can somehow hope. So, you know, for each point here, you have a bounded sequence of values, right? So for each point, you can pass to a subsequence using the classical compactness theorem, which converges. But this sequence is not going to converge everywhere, because at any point, you will have to take a different subsequence. But no, so this is not going to converge, what is sometimes called almost everywhere convergence. The answer will be no, I will convince you, right? So what is the right convergence? The right convergence here is the convergence in the sense of averages, which sometimes is called weak convergence. So such a sequence is typically called oscillatory sequence. So if I speak about oscillatory sequences, I mean something like that. Or oscillatory solutions means that my problem admits solutions of this type that may develop oscillations. And in particular, we will see that Euler is a problem like that, which is very bad. Okay, so there is something like weak convergence. What is weak convergence? Weak convergence means that instead of taking like pointwise values, I mean, I have to have something which is sort of countable, right? I mean, the number of points here, the points on the real line, this is a continuum, this is not a countable set. So if I want to have something like convergence up to subsequence or something, I have to have a countable set. And so this countable set is obtained by, instead of considering this pointwise values, I take some little neighborhood of a given point like B, and instead of considering the function, I take the integral of the function over this B. Right, so I take the integral gn, and now I hope that what this integral mean will converge to something. And this is what is called weak convergence. Right? And so this integral mean is at the beginning conveniently replaced by testing. So the integral mean is something like that you take the B, right? You take a function phi such that phi has compact support on B, and you take this average, right? Which is exactly what is written here. So I take function with compact support, and I take this average, and I wonder if this average converges to something for any phi, for instance. Well, you can show that there is a limit of that. Right, so this, I take the primitive function to the function small g, which is capital G, and since small g has zero mean, the primitive function is also periodic. If it did not have zero mean, the primitive would not be periodic. In particular, the primitive function is bounded because it's periodic. Okay, so now I look at my product. And so my integral, since this has bounded support, compact support, so the integral over R should be written in this way. So this is exactly that. And then I can integrate by parts because my function phi has compact support, so I can integrate by parts. And I don't see the boundary terms because phi has compact support. So I can put, I take the primitive of G, which is Gn, but since it is scaled by N, the primitive is 1 over N. This is the primitive. I mean, you can check that the derivative of this is small g, evidently. Multiply by the derivative of phi. Right? I do integration by part. Well, phi is a given function, so this is a kind of bounded, nice object, which is integrable. G is bounded. So the whole integral here is bounded. So bounded independently of n. The whole thing is bounded independently of n, but here there's 1 over n here. So the whole thing goes to 0. And so what is, so this 0 happens to be connected to that 0, right? So the conclusion is that if I have an oscillatory sequence where g is a periodic function and I rescan it by an x, then this converges to 0, which happens to be the average of g, dx. Well, now I take a function which is of an order. So now I would like to have a general statement, which would mean that if I have a function which is periodic and I rescale it like g and x, it converges to something what I can call g bar, which is going to be the average of g. Is that true? Well, evidently yes, because if I have a periodic function g, I can take g minus its average plus its average. Now this is a function which has average 0, which converges weakly to 0, what we have proved, but this is a constant function. It's clear that constant function converges weakly to the constant. So this is true. So for any periodic function, this rescaled sequence converges to its mean. Right? And so, and this is the unpleasant feature, so it has immediate consequence, which means that if I have a weakly converging function, the weakly converging sequence of functions, and I have some nonlinearity, so I have some nonlinear problem, for instance, Euler, there are nonlinearities, I would like to say, well, I know that gn converges weakly to g. Does it imply that if I take a nonlinear function, that the nonlinear function h will converge to h of g? Again, say weakly. But this is not true. I mean, that's very simple because, for instance, there's a classical example which is always shown to students. I take my favorite function, which is sinus and x is a periodic function which has zero mean. So according to the theorem we have proved, it converges weakly to 0. Then I take the function sinus square. This is like a h of z is equal to z square. Like I take a nonlinear function, and now this should converge again to the, according to the theorem, to the mean of sinus square. Sinus, mean of sinus square is not 0 because it's a positive function. It's actually 1/2. Right, and this 1/2 is not 0 square. So, and that's very bad, right? So, if we have a nonlinear problem, and if we cannot make sure that this does not happen, it's very difficult to show that, for instance, a sequence of approximate solutions will converge to the right limit because nonlinear functions are not weakly continuous. There are functions which has certain properties, like convex functions can be weakly lower semi-continuous, which is again well known, so I apologize for this. Example. So there could be convex, there could be functions which behave in some way decently with respect to weak convergence, for instance, convex functions. So, they have the following property. So, assume that I have gn which converges weakly to g in this sense, for instance, and then I take h which is convex. And then I take h of gn. And so it can be shown. I will show the proof. It looks like it's very mysterious, but the proof is not really difficult. It can be shown. This is what is called weak lower semi-continuity of convex functions. It can be shown that h of g, I mean, if I take h and apply it to the limit function, is less or equal than the mean when n goes to infinity of h of gn. This is called weak lower semi-continuity. And so this is related to the fact that, for instance, okay, usually one writes integral here, right, for some over some set. But since this is true for any set, it's true also for the limit. So there is a classical example which is usually introduced in the context of Hilbert spaces. So you take the function, the space L2, for instance, functions which are square integrable on the set omega. So this is a space of functions which which has the property that that the square is integrable, right? And so now this is the convergence in averages, is the so-called weak convergence on this Hilbert space, which can be defined in a different way. I mean, functional analysis people like to introduce it by means of duality, right? The weak topology is the weakest topology, which makes all the linear forms continuous and so on. But it's exactly what I said. It's convergence in averages. And then the classical example is that the norm in this space, which happened to be the integral over G squared, right? Because it's a weakly Lober semi-continuous, which means that the norm of G, you can write it squared, doesn't matter. The norm of G squared is less or equal than the min in the space L2, the min L cosine of the norms of Gn. Right, and now the norm is, of course, a convex function, so this somehow confirms what I said here. But now usually people start with this inequality and they say, well, if I have a convex function, I mean, is it true? And it's not really difficult to see. Let me show you the proof of that, or at least a sketch of the proof, because we will be using this very often in what follows. So how you can prove this weak Lober semi-continuity? Okay, so let's be optimistic. Let's assume that we have nice convex functions, which is twice continuously differentiable, and such that here's two derivatives, for instance. So I use so I write h of gn. I use Tylor formula. So I just write. Now this is independent of the fact that gn is a physical sub-function that can be a number or whatever. So we have Tylor formula. Let's assume that h is a nice function, so this is equal to h of g, right? Plus, there is something like derivative that g of gn minus g. Plus, and now, according to Tyler formula, there are two derivatives somewhere of gn minus g squared. This is Tyler expansion. And this holds for any number gn and g. This is not related to functions, right? And now this is a fixed function. Now we assume that gn converges weakly to g. This is our assumption. So what happens with this term? Since gn converges weakly to g, of course gn minus g converges weakly to zero, I mean, that's obvious. So this is a given function, so weak convergence to zero means that if I take the integral, so let's take the integral over some domain, this goes to zero, right? Because this is like my test function. We would say it's not really smooth, but it can be extended. But this is a fixed function, this goes to zero, the averages of this go to zero, so this goes to zero, so this will disappear in the limit. But this, because h is convex, this is non-negative and this is square, so the whole thing here is non-negative, right? And that's it, so this goes to zero, this is h of g, and this I can write limit in. And so I have limit of a of gn is greater or equal, because this is greater or equal than zero, than this, which is exactly the result. And you may say, now you have omega, but this is true for any omega, so I can erase omega at the end of the day, right? By the theory of Rettig Boltzmann. So that's weak and Lober semi-continuity of convex functions, so we will use it very often. And as you see, this is not related to any mysterious property of the norm, or sometimes people attribute this to the fact that the Hilbert space L2 is strictly convex or whatever. No, it's just this Tylor expansion. Okay. So this is the better. So that's the first example that something is not good, because in particular, if I have a sequence, for instance, of approximate numerical solutions, I cannot pass with the limit in the nonlinear problem. But it could be even worse, because here at least we have some convergence, right? Right? We have a sequence which is bounded. This sequence is bounded, so this corresponds to the situation when I have a sequence, say, an infinity solution that are uniformly bounded. But it could be even worse. It could be that I really don't have any uniform bound, only integral bound, and this is the problem of concentration. So what is the problem of concentrations? On the next slide. This is really very elementary, so I apologize for that. But since we will speak continually about concentrations and oscillations, so there is another example. So let's take a function g now. Now, g is not periodic, but we take something which has compact support between minus 1 and 1. This is my g now. And I take something which looks like this, basically. And I assume that the integral of gx is equal to 1. G is a non-negative function. So if you are familiar, well, I suppose with the cerebralytic spaces, this means that the norm of G in the space L1 is bounded by 1, or it's actually equal to 1. L1 on the whole. And now I take a sequence which is done by rescaling of this function. So I take gn, which is ng of nx. So if I make g of nx, it means that instead of having this, I have to rescale this to 1 over n. But I multiply by n. So I take something which is sort of slimmer, but larger. So I have this is my sequence gn. And you can check by direct computation that actually the integral of this new sequence is also equal to 1 because of I did the scaling in such a way. So the integral, so this is something what's sometimes called regularizing kernel sequence. But this is a sequence of functions which is bounded only in the space L1. Now, you would like to say, gn converges. So do we have some convergence? Gn should converge to some g. But now, we cannot say, we would like to say something like the gn converges weakly. So the weak limit means that I take the product gn of phi, and I would like to say that this converges to some function g multiplied by phi as before. Right? So what about the weak convergence? But you say here, this is not so bad because actually, this sequence has a, you may say, oh, there is a strong limit of this sequence, right? Why? Because this is a sequence which converges to zero everywhere except at zero, right? It's clear that this is a sequence. So gn of x converges to zero for all x which are not zero. But still, I cannot apply what is called Lebesgue theorem because I do not have what is called dominant function, right? It is not true that this sequence converges to zero in the space L1, in the norm of the space, because the integral does not converge to zero, it's equal to 1. So to what it converges, and it even does not converge to any function in this weak sense, because if you compute it, what is this integral? Okay, so this is the integral. So again, I take a function which has compact support, a function phi, and I compute this integral. So since gn has support between minus 1 over n and plus 1 over n, this integral is equal only to that. And so this, if I take, so gn is a non-negative sequence which has integral equal to 1. So this is definitely less if I take the supremum of phi and multiply this by integral gn, which is this, and I take the infimum. And since phi is a continuous function, so this is infimum and this is supremum of phi on a very small interval, but since phi is a continuous function, this necessarily converges to the value of phi at the point zero. And so the limit of this, my sequence, is not really any integral of this. It's like the value of phi at the point zero, which sometimes in functional analysis, this is sometimes interpreted like that g is equal to what is called Dirac function at the point zero, or Dirac mass. This happens to be a measure. And so it may happen, so this is the worst thing that may happen to you if you handle nonlinear problems. not only that you may have oscillations, but here it means that you also do not have any information about how the functions are bounded. I mean, you only know that they are bounded in L1. Okay, if you even don't know this, then I don't know what you would do. I mean, if you have no bounds, there is no chance to get anything. But this is a sort of weakest bound you can expect to get. And in this case, you have to leave the space of functions, right? You cannot work in the space of functions. You have to switch to the space of measures because, roughly speaking, this function L1 is not a dual space of any finite space L1, but so you have to embed it in the space of measures. And the measures happen to be the dual space of the space of continuous functions, and so you can speak about weak limit. Now, this limit is sometimes denoted weak star limit, which means the limit in the dual space to C, which means that this holds for any continuous function phi. Now, the limit is not a function, it's a measure. And so that's even bad. I mean, that's even worse than before because, for instance, now if I take a superposition, for instance, I would like to say what is gn squared. But gn squared, it's not even bounded in anything. So I even don't have any reasonable limit on it. So this is even worse than oscillation, I would say. So in the nonlinear problems we will be studying, we will be facing these two kinds of problems. The first one will be, so this is related to what you can say about solutions of a given problem. If you can make sure that solutions of Euler, like U, the bound which is uniform, at least in the space of uniformly bounded orbital infinity functions, then the only problem, so to speak, you are facing is the problem of oscillations. But if you have only this, then you may have also concentrations. And these two phenomena can combine. I mean, you may have, of course, you can imagine that you have a function which at some point behaves like that, and another point behaves like oscillating. And so these are the main bad phenomena we will have to deal with, we will have to handle when studying the Euler system. Okay, so I'm sorry for this very classic introduction. Now, I will start with some introduction of problems. So actually, there are two theories in the analysis of nonlinear system. The first one was optimistic. Sometimes it's called the theory of compensated compactness. So I will discuss the possibility. That's basically, I go back to the title of my talk. I will discuss the possibility of having these two phenomena in solutions of certain nonlinear problems. And so there are two things that go somehow, they are contradictory. So the first theory, which was developed in the 80s, was the theory that's usually called compensated compactness. And I think the name that should be mentioned here is, French people like Victor Perret. But if you like more British, then you can have John Bohr. And of course, in the context of Euler, I should mention Roland Wittemann. And if there are Russians, they would like to have Reshetnyak. And I would say, on the other hand, we have this convex integration. And this is exactly really like two antipodes of one thing. This is not exact. I don't have any proper name for that. I would say the theory of oscillatory solutions. So here, this theory developed in the 80s, there was a belief that actually, if you have a decent problem that comes from physics, oscillations are not allowed. Which means that even if you don't see it like explicitly, I mean, I write down the Euler system, and you would say, we don't know if there are oscillations or not. But the philosophy was the oscillations will not be there. And there are two things that may sort of prevent oscillations. The first one is just the data, right? You may have a smooth data that somehow do not allow the solutions to oscillate. Somehow the smoothness is transported by the equations itself. Although the problem itself, I will show you a very simple example of a linear transport equation, where the problem itself admits oscillations. However, if you take the initial data, well, simple transport equation means that you have the initial data like that and they are simply transported in some direction. So clearly, if you take the initial data that oscillate, then the oscillations will propagate and you will have a problem that allows oscillation. But if you take the initial data that do not oscillate, the problem will not allow oscillations. So either the data or the equations themselves will sort of impose certain restrictions because they come from physics, so they should be nice. They would impose certain restrictions that would not allow solutions to oscillate. And so actually the solution set will be compact and we will apply at the end of the day some kind of, okay, in mathematics we would do some proof. In numerics, we would devise some numerical scheme, and the numerical scheme will give rise to non-oscillatory objects, and they will converge to solutions of the problem, and this would be nice. That's compensated compactness. Well, on the other hand, this theory of convex integration shows us that, unfortunately, there are physical problems where do admit oscillations, so there are oscillations. There could be also concentrations, but for us, it's enough to see that there will be oscillations, and this has a lot of other unpleasant phenomena, however, so which means that there is basically no stability of solution. I mean, you do not find any topology in which you would say that solutions are stable. If you perturb it, you stay in a compact set or something. On the other hand, there is a very surprising, at least for me, I would say what I would call positive effect, is that we would have, so it looked like this is the only hope how you solve nonlinear problems. I mean, in the mathematical sense, we are mathematicians, so for a mathematician, for me, solving problem means showing the solution exists. There's a lot of jokes about it. But for mathematicians, solving means solution exists. It's clear that, or at least naively, if you do not have compactness, means if this is not true, if you cannot have compactness in some sense, then you cannot solve the problem. How would you solve it? I mean, you would construct approximations, but they would not converge. Well, strangely enough, this convex integration gives you a method how to not solve problems, which means you are not constructing any approximations. However, you prove mathematically that there exists solutions by using, in a clever way, combining these oscillatory waves, so to speak. So surprisingly, and this is the nice byproduct of this Onsager's conjecture story, is that this method gives you existence of solutions. But you know, as God is always like, so you pray, I would like to have solutions, so you get existence, but there is a negative aspect of that, you will get infinitely many of them, right? So it's like in these fairy tales that somebody wanted something and then you get too much. And that's exactly the case here. So the method not only gives you existence, but you will get infinitely many. You wanted one, why not infinitely many? So this is exactly opposite to this philosophy, because here, of course, this doesn't give you uniqueness, but you somehow hope in the set of solutions is compact, there are not so many solutions. Right? I mean, compact sets are usually kind of small, although it's not really true, right? There could be very complicated compact sets. But here you get existence by the method, because you have oscillations, so the method really works like that you can sort of construct solutions or prove existence by using this oscillatory, so by the possibility of having oscillatory solutions or oscillatory waves. But unfortunately, you would have many of them, and that's the negative aspect, because, so in particular, for instance, for this three-dimensional Euler system, I think now it's time to finish the first part of the talk. So for this three-dimensional Euler system, so if you are in space dimension 3, existence of global in-time solutions, of weak solutions, okay, these solutions will be weak. I mean, if they oscillate, they cannot have derivatives. If you have derivatives, bounded and solutions cannot oscillate, right? Bounded derivatives prevent oscillation. I mean, if you have bounded derivatives of some sequence, then the sequence converges uniformly for instance, on one dimensional space. So here, for instance, the existence of, okay, so I should really make it a little bit less messy. So the existence of what is called globally in time, which means for any time, weak solutions for this problem for Euler has been open. I mean, it was not known whether or not you have global in time weak solutions. For Navier-Stokes, we know there's a theory by Lerre, but for Euler, the existence for any initial data of global in time weak solutions is an open, it has been an open problem. Well, using this theory, Emil Wiedemann finally showed that this problem, and the proof is really, I would say, straightforward adaptation of this method. Like, so this was, I would say, this was basically proved by Lerre. Of course, I do not want to take any liquid out of it. But the proof is really based on these ideas. Now we know for this problem, for any initial data, we have existence of solution, global in time solution. And, but infinitely many in addition. And we will have to do, we will do the same. And this is basically what I would like to show you in this course. And I will show you how to apply the same results to compressible where you also get, where the problem was also completely open. So on one hand, like mathematicians, we should be happy because the method gives us existence of solutions, but no compactness, which means that there is basically no explicit possibility to compute these solutions. And there are infinitely many. So the problem is now what to do with such a situation. So, because there are infinitely many solutions, so apparently this cannot be used in physics or engineering, whatever, because you want one solution, because you would like to predict what happens. Like, it's not only engineering problem, you can think about applications in meteorology. So you have infinitely many, so you should say what is a good solution, right? Good means that. So, for instance, these infinitely many solutions, they still violate the energy inequality, right? Because you cannot have, like, infinitely many that do satisfy energy inequality and start from any data. This is impossible, I explain why. So you may say good solution is a solution which does not violate energy inequality. You may say good solution is a solution which minimizes the, whatever you like. Tell me what is the criterion, but the question is whether or not if you identify the good solution by some method, whether or not you can forget this. And I will show you that in many cases, actually, even if you impose some extra hypothesis, in particular in the context of compressible Euler, you still keep infinitely many solutions. In particular, the energy dissipating solutions for certain data are still infinitely many. Right, so these are two. So actually, 80s and all this optimistic part on fluid mechanics is related to that in each good problem there is some compactness. I do not claim that these people believe that in each problem, but that was somehow the philosophy that everything will be solved by that. Now we know that unfortunately there are problems where we do not hope to do that because there is simply no compactness. You don't, unless you find something more, which we still don't know what it is, but maybe some of these guys know better than me, then we still face the problem of field postness. So that's the beginning of the story. I think now it's time for break, and after the break I'll continue with some examples. So maybe I should ask for questions. I don't see anybody there. I see only the blackboard. Questions?
Okay, thanks for your very nice talk. So, we have no questions right now. Are you able to hear us?
Yeah, I am hearing you.
And your writing is very legible. So, thanks for adapting. So, that's we appreciate it.
I was thinking the opposite.
Fair enough. So, that is fine with us. So, we may have to speak to the technical person in a while, but with you, it is all perfect. Thank you.
Okay, so then you'll meet in half an hour, right?
Sure.
11:30.
Ready to the shifting the slide.